the biosphere. The biosphere consists of all life on Earth and all parts of the Earth in which life exists, including land, water, and the atmosphere. The biosphere contains every organism from bacteria living underground to giant trees in rainforests, whales in parasites, most sport drifting through the air, and of course, humans. Organisms in the biosphere interact with each other and with their surroundings or environment. The story of this interaction is called ecology. Ecology is a scientific study of interaction among organisms and between organisms and their physical environment. Ecological studies may focus on levels of organization that includes the species or individual organisms that are a group of similar organisms, a population that is a group of individuals that belong to the same species and live in the same area, a community that is an assemblage of different populations that live together in a defined area, an ecosystem that are all the organisms that live in a place, together with their physical environment. A biome, that is a group of ecosystems that share similar climates and typical organisms. And our entire planet, which with all the organisms and physical environment is known as the biosphere. Ecologists use the word environment to refer to all conditions or factors surrounding an organism. Environmental conditions include biotic and abiotic factors. Biotic factors is any living part of the environment in which an organism might interact, including animals, plants, mushrooms, and bacteria. Abiotic factors is any non-living part of the environment, such as sunlight, heat, precipitation, humidity, wind or water current, soil type, and so on.
Producers and consumers. What are the first producers of energy-rich compounds that are later used by other organisms? Organisms need energy for growth, reproduction, and their own metabolic process. Organisms can only use energy from other sources. Researchers have discovered that there are other energy sources for life. For some organisms, chemical energy. Only algae, certain bacteria, and plants capture energy from sunlight or chemicals. Photosynthesis captures life's energy and uses it to power chemical reactions that convert carbon dioxide and water into oxygen. Deep sea ecosystems depend on primary producers that harness chemical energy from inorganic molecules, such as hydrogen sulfide. These organisms carry out a process called chemosynthesis, in which chemical energy is used to produce carbohydrates as shown. Some chemosynthesis bacteria live in harsh environments. How do consumers obtain energy and nutrients? Organisms that rely on other organisms for energy and nutrients are called consumers. Types of consumers. Consumers are classified by the ways in which they acquire energy and nutrients. First, we have carnivores. They kill and eat other animals. Carnivores include snakes, dogs, cats, and this high rival odor. Catching and killing prey can be difficult and requires energy, but meat is generally rich in nutrients and energy and easy to digest. Herbivores, like Davnago, obtain energy and nutrients by eating plants' leaves, roots, seeds, or fruits. Common herbivores include calves, caterpillars, and deer. Scavengers are animals that consume these carcasses of other animals that have been killed by predators or have died for other causes. This king vulture is scavengers. Omnivores are animals whose diets naturally include a variety of different foods that usually include both plants and animals. Humans, bears, pigs, and this white-nosed coyote are omnivores. Decomposers, such as bacteria and fungi, but they decay caused by decomposers in part of a process that produces detritus, the small pieces of dead and decaying plant and animal remains. Detritivores, like this giant earthworm feed on detritus particles after chewing or grinding them into some even smaller pieces. Many times with mites, snails, shrimp, and crabs are detritivores. Detritivores commonly digest decomposers that live on and in detritus particles. Moreover, organisms in nature often do not stay inside the TD categories ecologists place them in.
Particles of matter recycled in the biosphere. How does matter move through the biosphere? Matter moves through the biosphere differently than the way in which energy moves. Solar and chemical energy are captured by primary producers and then passed in a one-way fashion from one tropic level to the next, dissipated in the environment as heat along the way. Unlike the one-way flow of energy, matter is recycled within and between ecosystems. Elements pass from one organism to another and among parts of the biosphere through closed-loop called biochemical cycles. Biochemical cycles. There are many ways in which the processes involved in biochemical cycles can be classified. Here we will use the following guidelines. Biological process. Biological process consists of any and all activities performed by living organisms. Geological process. Geological process include volcanic eruption, deformation and breakdown of rock, and major movement of matter within and below the surface of air. Chemical and physical processes. Chemical and physical processes include the formation of clouds and precipitation, the flow of running water, and the action of lightning. Human activity. Human activity that affects cycles of matter on a global scale include the mining and burning of fossil fuel, the clearing of land for building and farming, the burning of forests, and the manufacture and use of fertilizers. The water cycle. How does water cycle through the biosphere? Every time you see rain or snow, or watch a river flow, you are witnessing part of the water cycle. Water continually moves between the ocean, the atmosphere, and the land, sometimes outside living organisms and sometimes inside them.
The chemical substance that an organism needs to sustain life are called nutrients. Every organism needs nutrients to build tissues and carry out life functions. Like water, nutrients pass through organisms and the environment through biochemical cycles. The three pathways or cycles that move carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus through the biosphere are especially critical for life. Oxygen gas in the atmosphere is released by one of the most important of all biological activities, photosynthesis. Oxygen is used in respiration by all multicellular forms of life and many single-celled organisms as well. Carbon is a major component of all organic compounds, including carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids. In fact, carbon is a key ingredient of living tissue and ecosystems that life on Earth is often described as carbon-based life. Carbon in the form of calcium carbonate is an important component of many different kinds of animal skeletons and is also found in several kinds of rocks. Carbon and oxygen form carbon dioxide gas, which is an important component of the atmosphere and is dissolved in oceans. All organisms require nitrogen to make amino acids, which combine to form DNA and RNA. Many different forms of nitrogen occur naturally in the biosphere. Nitrogen gas makes up 78% of Earth's atmosphere. Nitrogen containing substances as ammonia, nitrate ions, and nitrate ions are found in soil, in the waste produced by many organisms, and in the atmosphere, the carbon dioxide gas. Although nitrogen gas is the most common form of nitrogen in the Earth, only certain kinds of bacteria can be formulated. The bacteria convert nitrogen gas into nitrogen. A process known as nitrogen fixation. Other bacteria obtain energy by converting nitrates into nitrogen gas, which is released into the atmosphere in a process called denitrification. Phosphorus is essential for living organisms because it forms a part of vital molecules such as DNA and RNA. Also, phosphorus is of great biological importance. It is not only vital, like carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen. Phosphorus does not enter the atmosphere in significant amounts.
If apples of land and water are available, the primary productivity of an ecosystem may be limited by the ability of nutrients. If even a single essential nutrient is in short supply, primary producer will be limited to nutrient with supply when this producer is called limited nutrient. Nutrient limitation is so. In output to reach so the growth of crop plants is typically limited by one or more nutrients that must be taken up by plants through their roots. Micronutrients such as calcium, magnesium, sulfur, iron, and manganese are necessary in relatively